The growth of the city of Wilmington, North Carolina, has completely urbanized the Carolina Bay known as Blythe Bay in less than 100 years. Wilmington is a port city in North Carolina that served as a major transportation gateway to the interior of Colonial America by the Cape Fear River. Today, Wilmington offers tourists a scenic waterfront walkway that winds around the Cape Fear River to three island beaches. Welcome to another edition of the Carolina Bay of the Day, where we study the secondary impacts made by the glacier ice boulders that were ejected by one or more extraterrestrial impacts on the Laurentide ice sheet. Blythe Bay is situated in a strip of land between the Cape Fear River and the Atlantic Ocean. North Carolina sticks out into the Atlantic Ocean, and it has been hit by 55 hurricanes since 1851, making it the most hurricane-prone state that doesn't border the Gulf of Mexico. Blythe Bay shows evidence of the storm surges that have flooded the area since the Carolina Bays were created. The colorized topography of this LiDAR image provides a clear view of Blythe Bay. The rim has an elevation of 15 meters above sea level. The center of the bay has an elevation of 9 meters above sea level, but most of the area within the bay has an elevation of 13 meters above sea level. There's a link to the LiDAR visualization tool for Google Earth by Michael Davias in the description of the video. A closer view shows a drainage channel through the northeast rim of the bay. This channel can help to drain the bay, but it also exposes it to flooding during storm surges. A satellite image of the same area shows only city streets and a residential neighborhood. Looking at this image, we would not know that this is the center of a large Carolina bay. Even though Blythe Bay is now completely covered with houses, it was not always so. A book by Henry Savage titled The Mysterious Carolina Bays, published in 1982, included an expansive view of Carolina Bay research and a significant number of black and white photographs of bays, including Blythe Bay. Savage wrote that Blythe Bay was investigated extensively. In 1943, B.W. Wells of North Carolina State College reported to the Elisha Mitchell Scientific Society the preliminary conclusions of the study he had made of Blythe Bay in the southeastern suburban area of Wilmington, North Carolina. His work would later become part of one of the most intriguing research studies in Carolina Bay literature. He told the society that in Blythe Bay, the interior of which is about 35 feet above mean sea level, he had found 5 or 6 feet of typical bay peat lying beneath 7 feet of plastic clay and fine sedimentation which could only have been deposited there through an invasion by the sea during a temporary re-elevation of the ocean that had occurred long after the bay had come into existence. There is no information of when this photograph was taken, but many of these pictures are from aerial surveys conducted in the 1930s. The caption of Plate 20 says, Blythe Bay, southeast of Wilmington in New Hanover County as it appeared before it was engulfed by the expanding city. The subject of studies by B.W. Wells, Blythe Bay produced evidence of a substantial rise and fall of the sea in respect to this part of the Atlantic shore in recent geological times. Note that the wind-blown sands have filled the northwest end of the bay and encroached on its western rim opposite its small neighbor. The LiDAR image shows the sandy encroachment into Blythe Bay. The hypothesis that the Carolina Bays were created by wind and water mechanisms always assumes that such sand sheets were created by wind-blown sand. However, the impact hypothesis proposes that many of these sand sheets adjacent to bodies of water were caused by splashes of sediment ejected by impacts on the river. The elliptical geometry of the Carolina Bays is a clue that the bays originated as inclined conical cavities because ellipses are conic sections. In this case, the sand sheet originated from mud splashed by an impact along the Cape Fear River, as will be explained later. A previous video about Big Bay in South Carolina discussed another instance where the impacts of glacier ice boulders on the watery river created splash chevrons that overlaid Big Bay. The impacts on the river created splashes that dredged the bank of the river and carried the sand over Big Bay. Then a small ice projectile with a higher trajectory made the Carolina Bay on top of the sand sheet. This is the pattern that is observed frequently around rivers. First, an impact adjacent to the river creates an impact basin. Next, an impact in the river produces a splash that carries some sediment that gets deposited as a sand sheet on the first basin. And finally, a small projectile with a long loft time makes an impact on the sand sheet. Kelly Bay in South Carolina was also reviewed in a previous video. The sequence of events that produced this geological formation has the same pattern as Big Bay. An impact adjacent to the Little PD River created the Kelly Impact Basin. Next, one or more impacts on the Little PD River made splashes that carried sediment on top of Kelly Bay. As in the case of Big Bay, a small ice projectile with a higher trajectory and a longer loft time impacted the splash chevrons on Kelly Bay, providing evidence of the sequence in which the features of this terrain were formed. We now come back to Blythe Bay to apply the geological law of superposition and demonstrate a sequence where Blythe Bay was created first, followed by an impact on the Cape Fear River that splashed some sediment on Blythe Bay, and then some smaller projectiles impacted on top of the splashed sediment. Blythe Bay has elliptical geometry and raised rims. Since ellipses are conic sections, this indicates that Blythe Bay originated as an inclined conical cavity, like a penetration funnel. An impact on the Cape Fear River then splashed some sediment on the west part of Blythe Bay. Unfortunately, impacts in rivers are eroded very quickly. All that we can see today is a broad drainage channel. Even though no impact basin can be seen today, the direction of the splash is from the northwest direction. The prevailing wind in North Carolina is from the southwest for 10 months of the year and from the northeast during September and October. Thus, it is unlikely that the sand sheet over Blythe Bay is due to the wind as mentioned by Henry Savage. Following the formation of the sediment deposit by an impact on the Cape Fear River, two ice projectiles impacted the newly formed sand sheet and made the basins labeled B and C. Close inspection shows that the sand sheet stops precisely at the northwest boundary of Basin B. This could only have happened if Basin B was in place after the sand sheet. Similarly, the basin labeled C is on top of the sand sheet. A sand sheet created by the wind would not have respected the boundaries of these two basins. Basins B and C have the elliptical geometry of Carolina Bays and the same axial orientation as Blythe Bay. These basins look small in comparison to Blythe Bay, but even the small one is bigger than the Rose Bowl football stadium in Pasadena, California. Blythe Bay has the encroachment of sand sheets found in many Carolina bays that are adjacent to rivers. The most logical explanation is that during the ballistic sedimentation of the ejecta curtain created by the extraterrestrial impact on the Laurentide ice sheet, the secondary impacts in the rivers ejected sediment that covered the nearby bays, and we can determine the sequence of events using the geological law of superposition because ice projectiles with long loft times impacted the sand sheets. Blythe Bay is located 1,168 kilometers from Lake Michigan, which is assumed to be the point from which the ice boulder that made the bay was launched. The basin has a width of 1,808 meters and a length of 2,880 meters. The width-to-length ratio corresponds to an impact angle of 38.9 degrees. The diameter of the glacier ice projectile that made the basin is estimated to be 576 meters, which is one-fifth of the basin length. The ballistic equations indicate that the glacier ice boulder that made Blythe Bay was launched at a speed of 3.424 kilometers per second. It had a flight time of 7.31 minutes and reached a height of 236 kilometers above the surface of the Earth. The trajectory was a suborbital space flight in the vacuum of space. Bay B was in place 18 seconds after Blythe Bay, and Bay C followed 5 seconds later. The kinetic energy of the impact that made Blythe Bay was equivalent to 129 megatons of TNT, which would have caused seismic vibrations of magnitude 8.89. Bay B was made by an impact of 5 megatons, and the impact that made the small bay C had energy of 174 kilotons, which is 10 times more than the bomb dropped on Hiroshima. I became interested in examining Blythe Bay because Henry Savage had published some historical images from the time before the bay became engulfed by the city of Wilmington. When I started, I did not imagine that Blythe Bay had been created by the same type of mechanism that formed Kelly Bay and Big Bay. While I was exploring the Wilmington area, I noticed a well-preserved impact basin 4.6 kilometers northeast of Blythe Bay. This Carolina Bay has a length of 530 meters, and the LiDAR image revealed that the bay has a baseball field. The satellite image shows that this Carolina Bay is in the middle of the campus of the University of North Carolina at Wilmington and contains several athletic fields. I was there in 2017, and I took a picture of the soccer field, which has one corner on the rim of the bay, and this makes the lines look curved. Thank you for joining me in the investigation of the Carolina Bays and the Younger Dryas Cataclysm. I will continue to examine the Carolina Bays one bay at a time. My book about the Carolina Bays is available at Amazon. Please subscribe to my YouTube channel to be notified of future videos about the Carolina Bays.